Hi friends, this is Pete, call sign K7PP, amateur radio, and we're out here in the shop and we're going to do the alignment on the Hammarlund HQ170 Alpha. Going to start out with, first of all, making sure that the unit has got operational controls. Make sure all the controls work. Starting out with the on and off switch, which seems to be working fine. The audio gain seems to be working fine. RF gain seems to be working okay. Band switch seems to be free and moving okay. The send, receive, calibrate. Calibrate is working okay, and we'll look at antenna, and we'll get up nice and close so we can see, and I'm going to peak the antenna. That control seems to be working all right. The AVC, a little more difficult, but a pulse noise will take the meter all the way over, and if I can get up close you can see it, and you'll notice how it slowly comes back to quiescent. So that's the slow AVC position. Fast position, we'll do the same thing again, and it should come back, gain wise should come back instantly as soon as the noise pulse goes away. That's not a real good demonstration, but it does indicate that it's working. And that's basically all we're after. We have the ability to disable the AVC, that works. And I guess the next thing would be to make sure the mode switch is working. We've got AM, we're in that mode. There's the CW mode and the CW adjustment. Can't get it to, there we go. It'll have to be in CW. Okay, CW adjustment's working. And on the A model, when you're in sideband, the beat frequency oscillator is not adjustable, it's fixed. Okay, so we know that works. Let's take a look at the calibration. Now let's get over here where we can see it a little better. And if we look at the dial, I can change the dial pointer. So when we go to calibrate, I can set it exactly where the calibration says it should be. The meter, we agreed that's working all right. The next thing would be to look at the slot adjustment or notch adjustment. I'm going to pick a signal. By the way, here's where the slot frequency adjustment is. I'm going to increase the slot depth, so it's going to all but notch out the signal completely. And we're going to go over and look at the S meter. We're going to tune the signal in. And then we're going to adjust. There we go. So by adjusting the slot depth, I can actually notch out that signal, get rid of it altogether. So if I'm trying to listen to something close by, I can actually get rid of a signal that might be interfering with me. And usually the slot depth is adjusted all the way over to one side. Okay, I guess the next thing would be the bandwidth. I can adjust the window or bandwidth that we're receiving. And you can hear the response choke down. Which appears to be working quite well, actually, I'm surprised. So that we're only going to get kind of a very narrow bandwidth. I'm going to tune through it. So you can see how narrow that signal is. Very, very narrow. Go all the way wide open. Looks pretty good. Okay, without trying to get too deep into this, the bandwidth select basically defines a window of frequency response for the receiver. So in the 3 position, we're looking at roughly plus 3 and minus 3 kilohertz window or bandwidth for any incoming signals. 2 kilohertz, 1 kilohertz, and half a kilohertz. So there's actually 4 different bandwidths that can be selected. Moving on, if we go to single sideband mode, we want to look and see if the upper and lower sideband filters are working. That's pretty easily done. If we go to both, I hear a signal on one side, I hear a signal on the other side of center. Let me do that one more time. Negative, positive. In other words, either side of the center frequency has approximately the same signal strength. And if we want to get in here and look at the S meter real closely, we can see that. And we can see that it's off. How about that? So that's going to be something that we'll have to look at when we do the alignment. One side's got a little bit more signal strength than the other side. They should be both equal. Now let's look at the sideband filter. Let's look at lower sideband. If I tune to one side, signal goes away completely. I'm tuning lower in frequency, center, and the upper sideband, the other sideband, I should say, is there. Go to upper sideband, it should reverse. I go low in frequency, not much needle movement. Yep, definitely needs to be adjusted. Okay, it should go just the opposite. So an IF alignment is going to be definitely indicated. At least we'll have a starting point or a base point. Okay, have we forgotten anything? I don't think so. Oh, the clock. The clock is working. There's a switch that goes from off to automatic to on. There's automatic, and if I select the appropriate pointer position on the clock, the unit will come on by itself and get itself warmed up so that you're ready to use. Or you can turn it on manually, or you can turn it off completely. By the way, I don't know how many of these receivers I've purchased, probably a dozen of them over the last several years, and several of them have come to me, unit does not power up. Well, that's because somebody has turned the clock switch to the off position, which completely renders the on and off switch inoperative. So if you see that on eBay, it's probably because the guy doesn't realize that there's 2 on and off switches on the receiver. Okay, so we'll move on from here and get set up to do the alignment. With one other thing we didn't check out, completely forgot, the noise blanker. Here's the noise blanker, and the noise blanker is really good at taking care of pulse noise. and it's got a very minimal alignment. Basically, there are only two things to align, this transformer and this transformer, and they're both peaked for maximum. There's a metering point underneath the chassis, so we'll have to take the chassis, sub-chassis off the radio, flip it upside down, and then attach our meter to it, and then peak both of these transformers. I may or may not do that depending upon how well it works when I get the alignment done. Anyway, one of the ways we can tell if the noise blanker is working is to inject a signal into the receiver from the outside world, an antenna, and actually create some pulse noise. And I can do that by just making and breaking the antenna connection. Now, I'll kind of illustrate. Turn the calibrator off. Okay. So I have the blanker off right now. Pretty easy to see how noisy that can be. Now I'm going to turn it on. That's on. And that's off. So it looks like the noise blanker is doing its job. That's an awfully crude way to do it, but it's very effective. Pulse noise, like electric fences, ignition noise, and so forth, are dealt with pretty easily with this noise blanker. It's a unit that was developed for Hammarlund by a fellow by the name of Lamb, so they call it a Lamb noise blanker. And they came as a kit for those receivers that were not factory made. You could buy a kit to add on. You'll never see them on the market. They just don't exist. But looking this unit over, I've looked it over pretty easily, or looked at it, and it looks fairly easy to duplicate. And we're looking at two transformers, 260 kilohertz IF transformers, a couple of vacuum tubes, a mixer tube, a amplifying pentode, and a double diode, 6AL5, 6BA6, and 6BE6, and a little bit of B+, run the signal in, run the signal out, and you got yourself a noise blanker. And again, if you're ever on eBay or you're buying used radios, you can look, and the telltale sign is a concentric knob with a red knob in the center, which now becomes the limiter, and the concentric knob that used to be the limiter now becomes the noise blanker. So there you go. Now we'll set up for the actual alignment. Okay, before we start hooking up meters, let's take a look and see what we're working with. These receivers are fairly complicated looking, but if you kind of look at them in stages, they're really not all that complicated. So here's what we're looking at here. We'll just identify some of the parts and transformers. 6AQ5 is the audio output tube, and it develops water to into a low impedance speaker. It also has a 500 ohm winding, so that it basically has two impedances as far as your ability to drive a speaker or a line transformer or a foam patch or whatever. Very nice feature. 6AB6, which is a triode double diode, and it's basically an AVC clamp and a single stage triode audio frequency amplifier. This little guy right here, 6AL5, is a double diode, and it is a limiter, and it's an audio limiter, and can be switched on and adjusted from the front panel with the red knob that we indicated earlier. Moving back here, you'll notice that there's no 5U4. The A-series receivers are all solid-state rectifiers, double-diode, full-wave rectifier. OB2, 150-volt regulator tube, gas-fill tube, cold cathode. My instructor always used to ask me how the cathode was heated in the OB2s, and the term is called ionic bombardment. There's a whole series of gas-filled tubes that are heated that way with no filaments. And I can think of all sorts of them, like OZ4s and OA2s and so forth and so on. Anyway, they're all not heated tubes. They don't have a filament to light up. Anyway, just a bit of trivia there. These transformers right here, all six transformers, are single-stage transformers, and they're used to tune the particular bands. But you might say, there's more than six bands. Well, there is an extra coil underneath for the antenna and for the RF amplifier for the 6 meter band. And they're a smaller coil and didn't, for some reason, come with a can. Who knows? Anyway, these cans right here, there are three cans, but there's actually six coils inside, and they can be reached by using a tuning tool and tuning from the top and then pushing the tool all the way down and then tuning from the bottom. And so you can tune all of the bands except for 6 meters, which has to be tuned with the unit out of the case. And we'll get to that later. We're looking at a 6BZ6 amplifier tube, and 6BZ6 is a pentode, and it's used on all of the bands for RF amplification, and then the tuning for each of the bands. The high IF, which is located right here, or it's generated right here, and we're looking at a 3.35 megahertz, a 3.035 megahertz high IF, is generated with a local oscillator 6C4 and a pentagrid converter 6BE6. And by the way, there are lots of jammed versions of the 6BE6, so you might find these receivers with a different number tube in them. Don't get too worried. The jam tubes are actually pretty good. These transformers, same thing. There's a top-bottom, 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 and each one of these is an oscillator coil that generates the high IF, 3045 high IF. Moving further down, then we have another 6BE6 mixer, and there's a local oscillator that heterodynes against the high IF and generates 455 kilohertz, and that is the second IF frequency, and a little bit more selectivity generated. Moving along, the 455 again comes to another oscillator and 6BE6 mixer, and that generates the lowest IF, which is 60 kilohertz, and the 60 kilohertz moves its way down here. 60 kilohertz transformers, amplifier, transformers, amplifier, more transformers, until it gets down to the last 60 kilohertz IF amplifier, which is one half of a 6BV8 tube, which is a single triode double diode. And that guy drives a product detector, which is a 12AU7, and the 12AU7 is a double triode, which uses one half as a product detector and the other half as the beat frequency oscillator. So that's pretty much the layout. The device here that we were looking at earlier, which is a noise blanker, basically takes some signals out of the high IF, and it picks a frequency that's removed from the main IF frequency. It amplifies it, and then it generates a negative going signal that basically shuts off the mixer and turns off the, basically turns off the receiver's ability to hear anything for just a few microseconds until the pulse is gone. And then it turns everything back on, so you never know the difference. So anyway, that's how they do it. They just do a detection, phase inversion, and turn off the mixer. And that gets rid of the pulse noise. Pretty clever. So anyway, that's the layout of all of the tubes on the receiver. And I'm going to flip this thing over on its back and hook up some meters and hook up some signal generators, and we'll start injecting signals and tuning. Before we get started, I just happened to notice that when I hook up to an outside antenna, we're getting some precip static, and it's pretty noisy. And I just wanted you to hear it and see it, and I'm going to turn on the noise blanker. Pretty slick, wouldn't you think? Turn off the noise blanker. Makes a huge difference. S7, S5, S4, S3, 3, 4, 5. Holy cow. If you consider each S unit 6 dB, that's quite an attenuation of noise. So it works. Okay, here we are getting ready to do the alignment on the 170 alpha Hammarlund receiver. And one of the first things we need to do is to pick up our metering points, which we've done. What we've done is gone over to the very last stage, which is pin 2 of V13. And pin 2 of V13 is basically the same pin that is the grid of the S-meter driver. So, don't really know why we can't just use the S-meter, but hey, we'll just do it like the book says, because everybody's got their own way to do it. But anyway, we're hooked up, and we do have a reading on our VTVM, and yes, we're using a VTVM. And right now we're generating a 60 kilohertz signal, and just to make doubly darn sure that we're on the right frequency, the service monitor here is accurate to within 1 hertz, so we'll go ahead and try and get it exactly to the right frequency, although it probably doesn't matter. A little hard to do. Anyway, we're pretty doggone close to the right frequency here. We're looking at the middle scale. I think for an analog device, that's pretty close. There we go. Anyway, we're using the old trusty SG80. For the generation of the 60 kilohertz signal, and we'll hook that up via a little probe that we have here. This is a little probe that we use for injecting signals and making voltage measurements, and I'm going to go ahead and hook that up, and we'll go ahead and try and inject our signal. Okay, once we're all set up, we have to take and peak all of the stages, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11, those are the transformers. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11. So each one gets a peak, and I'll start up here at the top. And that one's peaked. 6, 7, 8, 9,
and ten and 11. So all of these 60 kilohertz transformers are now peaked for 60 kilohertz. Okay, the next thing we do is switch to CW mode, and then we have to make sure that our beat frequency oscillator is zero beat. Anyway, that's on this little transformer right next to the oscillator. This one's Z28, so. There it is, dead on. Okay, so the BFO transformer is now 0B. Okay, now we've got the low IF set. We need to set the 455 kilohertz IF. And we're injecting a signal in another spot. We're going down here to V2. And V2 is right next to the local oscillator, and we have to inject a signal on pin number 7 of V2, and we're going to go down and peak L4 for 455. So there's our L4 transformer, and got a tuning tool stuck in it. Now we're injecting 455, and we got a peak. Oh my. And there's our peak on 455. Okay, if I can get in here and see it, we have to peak several more coils, T1, T2, T3, T4, T5. T1 and T2, we're only supposed to peak the top coils. So we're going to be adjusting the high, the first IF, which is going to be the bottom a little later. But anyway, we'll go up here and see if we can't peak. Okay, there's a peak for T1, and we'll go over to T2, there's a peak there too, okay. Then we go up to the next transformer, T3, and T4. And last one's T5. Okay, so the 455 is tuned up. Okay, moving on to the next adjustment. They want us to adjust the slot depth. And the slot depth is the little notch control that I was showing you earlier. The notch control is right here. And the adjustment for the notch control is this coil right here. I believe it's pretty close. What they want you to do is tune for the middle of the band, or the tune for the middle of the adjustment range, and we're supposed to see a dip up here, and there's our dip. And if the dip isn't in the center of the range, we were supposed to adjust it for that, and as you can see, it's in the center of the range. So it looks like we don't have to adjust the notch adjustment at all. But if we had to, it would be this coil right here. Okay, so now that we've done the 60 and the 455, we're going to go and go up to the high IF, which is 30-35 kilohertz. But in order to do that, before you do that, you've got to switch the bands. The lower bands are configured so that there's a straight-through operation making them dual conversion on the lower bands, and it's only on the higher bands where the unit becomes a triple conversion. So they generate a high IF, they convert, generate another IF, convert, then generate another IF, and then detect. So what we're doing now is going for the triple conversion, the very highest IF. You might ask yourself what the conversion thing does for you. Well, it eliminates or reduces the tendency of the radio to tune in images of the frequency that you're after. Triple conversion receivers were found to really be quite superior in rejecting images altogether. Dual conversion, super. Single conversion, well, won't even go there. So anyway, we're injecting our signal in the same place, and we're going up here and generating a 3035, and we're looking up here at our meter reading, and we're going to go in and we're going to adjust the bottom of the coils, or transformers, the two transformers that we adjust the top of, and if I can fish that in there, and then go back up here without getting electrocuted, and there's our peak for 3035, next transformer, and there's our 3035. So that completes the overall IF tuning. Next thing we have to do is move on, and I think we'll go through at least one of the stages of the RF tuning. And the neat thing about that is that we can put the radio in the cabinet, pop the little trapdoor on the top open, and we can do the majority of it right through the top. All with the exception of 6 meters. And the 6 meter adjustments are the coils here. This is the antenna. This one down here is the RF tuning. You can see it in there. There we go. And this one right here is the local oscillator for 6 meters. It's almost like it's a different receiver. It even has a separate antenna connection on the back. So anyway, we'll get things unconfigured here and see what kind of operation we've achieved with this alignment. Okay, taking a quick look before we start buttoning things up here. Remember earlier we were running a test and we were checking for sideband suppression? Well, going back and doing the same test all over again on the both sideband position, you'll notice that when we tune either side, we pretty much got the same kind of a signal on both sides. When we turn to upper sideband, we should have, there's one sideband, there's the other sideband. Lots of suppression. Okay, now we'll turn to lower sideband. There's the other sideband, upper sideband. There's the lower sideband. It's perfectly balanced on both sides, and that's what we were after. And you saw how far off it was. Somebody golden screwdrivered the thing in earlier days and basically tuned for maximum smoke, and that explains why there wasn't any upper sideband suppression. But anyway, it's perfectly balanced now, and we'll go ahead and disconnect all the gear. Hello friends, this is Pete, ham radio call sign K7PP, and I wanted to add a little addendum to the video that you just went and looked at. I finished things up, put everything in a cabinet, took it up and put it in the ham shack, and everything worked really well on sideband and good sensitivity, but the AM sounded horrid. So back down to the shop and did a little bit more research. Now this is an Hammarlund HQ170 Alpha, and it turns out that the 170, the predecessor, had a little bit more information as far as the tuning procedures go. The Alpha service manual neglected to tell me that when we did the tune-up, it required that we be in the 0.5 kilohertz position on the bandwidth select, and the lower sideband without activating the VFO. So armed with that information, I did another alignment and went in and found out that my 60 kilohertz was off just a bit. Well, off enough to make things sound horrid. And leads me to believe now that you've got to be dead on if you're going to have a 60 kilohertz alignment. You've got to have a really good generator that's very, very accurate. So anyway, after doing another alignment on the low IF only, the 60 kilohertz, which encompasses these transformers right here, I set things up again with the signal generator, and this time I found that the audio was a lot better, and also decided to run a little test with pumping a little bit of music into the receiver just to see what kind of response I got. And okay, there's half a kilohertz. Sounds like it, doesn't it? But it's got a signal. One, two, three kilohertz. Looks pretty good. And down here, we're looking at the scope, and it looks quite good. The frequency response is there. And I might add that this is very easy to hook up because the Hammarlund has got an extra jack in the back for 450 kilohertz, 455 kilohertz output. So, you know, you can plug that into a station monitor scope or just about anything you want to watch other signals' audio quality directly off the air. So, anyway, I think we're ready to go and do another check, but I'm going to add this on to the original video so that if you do your alignments, do it as described, but make sure you got a really, really accurate 60 kilohertz generator, and also make sure that you're tuning up in the lower sideband with the 0.5 kilohertz position selected, and I think you'll have a lot more luck than I did. Anyway, we'll give it another try.